Well, thank you very much for this kind introduction. You really got it all right. And it's a good example already of one of my main points, that we need to be transparent. And it's good to be out on the web and to be visible for everyone with all the conflicts of interest which are there as well. I'm not going to declare them to you, but you can look them up. And if you want to know more about the stuff I'm about to present to you, the PDF is available for the ILSI organization. It will be distributed or put on a web or whatever. It can be completely open. And below the slides, I do have all the references I could find. It may be YouTube videos or TED Talks or even scientific publications and books. So my assignment for this afternoon is to talk about new developments in research integrity. And I put a few things on the menus. One is we see a shifting focus from the bad stuff, the deadly sins of science, like fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism, towards the more low-level questionable research practices. And I will argue that this is an important shift. Secondly, I will say a few things about the replication crisis. A lot of these have been said about it. And I will also allude to the most important solution to the replication crisis, namely being more transparent in different meanings of the word. And then I will say a few words about what stakeholders can do. There are no magic bullets in the field of research integrity. We need to collaborate with many stakeholders together to solve the issues. ILSI, I never heard about ILSI. I should not admit that here, of course, but it's the truth. I looked it up on the web, and I discovered that you're a bit of everything. You're a funder, you're a journal, and you're a research organization in one thing. So I'll mention a few things about these three types of organizations, what you can do about research integrity. And before this meeting started, we had a nice lunch together with this committee that has been introduced. And this feels now a little bit like carrying coals to Newcastle. You're doing a nice job already. And my only thing I want to do is to stimulate a little bit more to go on with this good work. It's really nice. Now, when someone is pontificating about research integrity, like I'm doing again this afternoon, you get a slide like this. This is the holiest of the holier, responsible conduct of research. This is where we all should be, and we should do relevant, valid, reproducible, and also efficient research. This is the bleak side. It's the research misconduct. It's the scientific fraud. These are the three deadly sins I mentioned already, the fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism. And in all codes of conduct in every country, you see FFP as being the deadly sins of science. Now, the interesting zone in between, and that's the focus of my presentation, is about sloppy science or questionable research practices, or like they have been coined recently, detrimental research practices. And it can be due to ignorance, then we need to teach each other better. It can be due to honest errors. Science is not easy, and you can make errors, of course. And it can also already be dubious integrity. When people start cutting corners because they want to make their papers more spectacular, more positive, more beautiful, because they know it's not good for science, but it's good for them, for their career, then you are already in the arena of dubious integrity. Now, there have been maybe 25 surveys, and there is a nice systematic reviews of a few years ago. Surveys do all the same. They ask, did you in the last 3 years engage in FF or P? And then surprisingly, 2% of the respondents say yes, on average. That means that when you are working in a department with 50 people, one of you is a fraud. Well, the guy will be in the other department, of course. They will have two frauds there, I know that, but still, on average. This is amazing, isn't it? And remember, this is a survey, so it won't be an overestimation. Most likely, it will be an underestimation. But it gets worse when you ask, did you engage in one of these typically 8 to 10 items of sloppy science? Then 1/3 of the respondents say, yes, I did. Isn't this amazing? So this is not an exception, it seems to be a rule. And again, this will be an underestimation as well. Now, one might wonder, can we rank the misbehaviors in research for awfulness, so to say? And that is what we set out to do a few years ago. We sent out another survey to all the ever participants of one of the World Conferences on Research Integrity, about 1,500 people or something like it. And we showed them a list of 60 misbehaviors, the really bad FFP stuff, until not asking permission to mention someone in an acknowledgement, a really, really minor, tiny thing, and everything in between. And of each of these 60 items, people should answer the question, how often do you think this occurs? And if it occurs, how awful is it in terms of impact on truth finding, on validity of science? And then, of course, we multiply these two elements with each other, and we rank them on the aggregated product scores. We did it for these experts of the research conference, and last year we did it with all the scientists in Amsterdam. There are about 7,000 scientists in Amsterdam, and we questioned them in a similar way. And these are their answer. That's Amsterdam. This is the top 5. There was a top 60, of course, but I'm going to show you only the top 5. You see that insufficient supervision and mentoring of junior co-worker is at the top. And by the way, this top 5 is almost identical to the top 5 of the experts of the World Conference. And this is always important, supervising junior scientists. And in fact, a number of you thanked your mentors and your supervisor, and rightly so, because these people are important. We learn the trade by looking at our role models and being taught by them. So this is important, and when the role models are not good, it's bad for science. Second one, let your own convictions influence the conclusions substantially. Now this is about non-financial conflict of interest. We know that already, these things happen. And you need to kill that as good as possible. It might be not completely possible, but you need to do that. Number 3, choosing a clearly inadequate research design or using wrong measurement instruments. Now this can happen in your trade as well. I was reading a book on the plane. I will tell a few words about it later on. And in that book, there was the example of a study where they compare cheese to butter. And in many aspects, that make cheese look a lot better for health, of course. And in my own field, when you look at drug research, when you study the efficacy of a drug and you compare it to a competing drug, which is not exactly meant for this type of patient, and then just to be sure, you dose it too low, yeah, well, then your favorite drug is going to win, of course. This is a questionable research practices at the start of the study, before the start of the study. Not publishing a valid negative study, that's recognizable as well, because this is the root cause of the replication crisis. Yeah, when all the negative studies are not published, the reproducibility will suffer, you can understand that. And the last one, insufficient attention to equipment skills and expertise, well, that's just really sloppy science, it's not doing a good job, and it's important to improve it when that is the case. Now please notice that F, F, or P are not on this list. In fact, they were in the bottom 30 of this top 60. And why is that? Not because our panels didn't consider them to be important, it is because the estimated frequency was so low. And when you multiply the two, they got low on the list. So when you give attention to improving science, this is where you should go. And this has everything to do with the way science works. And this is that dilemma I mentioned already before. It's not easy in science. We do have dilemmas, and we need to be more open about these dilemmas as well, I believe. The point is that what is good for you as a scientist is not always good for science as a whole. And that tension, to handle that, you need a moral compass. And here it is, the moral compass. And like a real compass, it has to do with the quality of the machinery, with the quality of the person which has the moral compass in their head. Really important is the external influence of the direct environment, the research climate. Research climate, I increasingly believe that is so important for the way how scientists behave. Remember, we are social animals. We copy behavior we see around us. When everyone around you in the lab is cutting corners, you start cutting corners yourself as well. It's unavoidable. And then, of course, there are these perverse incentives we have in the system of science. And nowadays in science, the frequent flyer mile is the citation, and everything is focused on citations in science. And understand me correctly, it's not bad to count citations, it's bad to only count citations, because then people are thinking that this is the only thing which is important. And furthermore, it can be cooked and cheated quite easily, citation scores. And that's what people do increasingly. So you need, when you are a good supervisor, you need to help a person to develop the compass, and you need to make a research climate which is open to your pupils, where people feel welcome to talk about their dilemmas, to talk about the errors they made, and to discuss the things they doubt. And one of the best things to start is to admit your own errors. We all made awful mistakes in our career. It's a good thing to open the discussion by starting talking about it. Now, this is maybe a bleak picture, but this is how it might work to some extent. We all know that positive results, they're wonderful. They're really wonderful, especially when they are quite spectacular. They bring you high-impact publications, Science, Nature, PNAS, Cell, what have you. They bring you a lot of citation, again, the frequent flyer mile, and they bring, when you're lucky, your media attention. And all these three help you to get the next grant, and in the long run, when you want to remain in science, tenure in an academical institute. Now, the point is, in a cynical way, that all these questionable research practices and also research misconduct can help you very well to get positive results. In fact, that's their only purpose. They're helping you to get positive results. They're great tools for that. Don't use the tools, but they're great tools to get positive results. And when you have these positive results by cooking and trimming, or worse, they will be difficult to reproduce. And that is, in a way, also behind the reproduction crisis. And the fact that we like positive results so much means that we hardly punish any negative results anymore. And that, again, leads to the reproducibility crisis. Now, pressure from within the person, your own interest, these interests, and pressure from the sponsor may nudge you towards using the toolbox of questionable research practices. And that is mainly what organizations and research in integrity offices and committees need to do, help people to withstand that nudging. One example, there are many, but this is one example, about negative results disappearing from the literature. This is one of the rare instances. Drug trials are the only instance I know where you have a gold standard. This is at the FDA level, 105 drug trials of anti-depression drugs. And the FDA, they look at the data, they ignore all your publication, they look at the data, and they decide whether it's a positive study or a negative study. That's the gold standard. Half of the studies of the 105 are positive, the other one are negative, the red ones. when you look a few years down the line, a few years down the line, you see that of the negative studies, only half is published, while with one exception, all the positive studies are published. That is publication bias already. And then you have cherry picking, outcome reporting bias, you can call that. You see it here. That means that when you do cherry picking in all data sets, there are a few positive elements. And when you ignore the negative outcomes and when you switch primary and secondary outcomes, and that's what people are doing, that has been documented, you see, like a miracle, some negative studies, according to the FDA, become positive when you look at the publications by the paper. And it gets worse. People know how to use spin in the sense that there are many ways to make a negative finding look nice, like almost positive, borderline significant. That's one of my favorites. It's really wonderful. That doesn't exist, borderline significant, but people write it all the time. It's amazing. And then you can at least shred some doubt, and these are the yellow dots to the negative findings, and it gets more positive again. And then you have the phenomenon of citation bias. We know, and two of my recent PhD students have been studying that, we know that positive studies are cited 3 to 5 times more often than negative studies. And that makes the green dots bigger and the few red dots remaining smaller. And when you compare this to that, I hope you will recognize that it is different. This is happening in the literature. And this is selective reporting all over the place. So we have to realize that. And it's a strong nudge towards more transparency and openness about everything we found and all the data. Now let's move on this replication crisis. Two headlines from Nature. It has been in all the newspapers internationally already. It's not documented that well, but we have the impression that only 10, up to 40% of research that is being done is replicable in the sense that if you do the same study over again, you get the same result. Now, you can say a lot about it, but this is basically not good enough. 100% is not realistic, probably, but this is too little. And these are the causes. We alluded to selective reporting already, I explained that. Low power is another one, when you do many small studies and don't bother about publishing the negative ones and publish only the positive ones, you get a completely weird picture in the literature, and a chance finding is not that easy to reproduce. Another way to explain the replicability crisis is p-hacking, that is doing funny stuff in statistics. Like my favorite biostatisticians always says, when you torture your data enough, they will always confess. And that's exactly what they do. That's exactly what they do. It's the Middle Ages of science, torturing of data. And this is a nice one as well, harking. It is hypothesizing after the results are known. We do that all the time in science. It's not a good habit. But this king understood it already. He shoots his arrow first, and then the lackey here makes sure he hits the bullet all the time. But this is what we do in science. We take a data set and we start fantasizing, how can this happen? And when we are a bit creative, we can make of a nice fantasy, and then you write down, I had a theory and I had an hypothesis, and look what I found. You're cheating. You should say, I was bored and I had a data set and I played around for weeks and I found a table I liked. This is it. Then you're honest. And then you can even say it might mean this, but it needs to be proven in the next study. So harking is an important cause probably as well. This is a wonderful article. I can really recommend it. It's by a few colleagues of Tilburg University in the Netherlands. And they wrote a kind of menu of cheating. They described 34 research degrees of freedom that can be used to get positive results. This is the data, this is the toolbox. This is the catalog of questionable research practices. Don't use them, but study them. Sorry. This is all about the flexibility you have in science when you do not declare before embarking on data collecting. You do not declare what you're going to do and put your protocol somewhere in the cyberspace where you cannot touch it anymore without leaving traces. And the same holds for the data analysis plan. Cheating in statistics is impossible when you have to park your data analysis plan in the cyberspace before looking at your data. Then the degrees of freedom are killed. Sorry, I'm getting a cold up here. This is a beautiful paper by John Ioannidis, one of my scientific heroes, and he explains in this article quite nicely why replication is in fact more important than innovation. Making a discovery is easy, but making sure that you are right, you're correct, is more difficult, it's more hard work. So replication is really more important, and original discoveries are often wrong for the reasons I told and for many more reasons. And before there is a replication, and typically you need a few more replications, don't trust them. Our philosopher of science, Karl Popper, knew that already. For him, it's no science when it's not replicable. Philosophy isn't that difficult. And this is the idea of transparency, and it's a kind of summary of what I've been told before. The idea is that prospectively, you have a study protocol, put it in the cyberspace, a really detailed study protocol, and you cannot touch it anymore without leaving traces, then everyone can check what you set out to do and compare that to what you publish and what you report. Same holds for data analysis plan, same holds for the amendments. Of course, you can have good ideas on the way and decide to do it differently, it's all right. But then you need to make an amendment and publish that time-stamped as well in the repository, so that everyone can figure out when the idea occurred. Sorry. You can also have your data sets in the repository and or your report. And I agree, it's nice to have it open. I like open access, I like open science, I like open data. But there may be good reasons not to have it open for everyone, and there may be good reasons to have it not open at all. Some stuff needs to be confidential, but there should always be good reasons for that. Essential is to do all this prospectively, so that it can be checked by an appointed committee. Now, the stakeholders. Let's look at the stakeholders. Let me start with scientific journals. What scientific journals can and should do is follow the top guidelines. These are guidelines, transparency for and openness prevention guidelines. I will allude to them later on. And I learned over lunch that ILSI is in the process of adopting these guidelines, which is really good. They can demand pre-registration. That is the idea what I just alluded to. Putting your protocols in your data analysis plan somewhere in a repository. And I will also say a few words about registered reports, which is a wonderful idea for journals. Using reporting guidelines, really important, because when you are reporting clearly, it's so much easier to check what is being done and whether it's being done right. And also, I really like the idea of having more preprints and post-publication peer review, and I have a slide on that as well. These are the top guidelines, the transparency and openness promotion guidelines. And the funny thing is that there are four levels. I left out two here. you can be a signatory, and 5,000 journals are signatory so far. of that guideline. And for instance, on level one, you can say we encourage data sharing or do nothing, or we encourage sharing of data or do nothing. And when you're on level three, you make it mandatory to put it all in the trusted repository and to reproduce all the analysis. So you can make your choice as a journal where you want to be in this continuum. And it's really nice, and there is always a challenge whether you want to go one level up or not. This is, again, a slide on the pre-registration. This is by one of the guys who started it all, Brian Nosek. He's running the Open Science Framework and the Center for Open Science. They're doing really wonderful work. I like this paper specifically because it explains why pre-registration is such an important idea. He even goes so far that he says, don't bother about statistics when there is no pre-registration. Just forget about it. You can calculate p-values, but they mean nothing. It only means something when it is a pre-registered protocol and a pre-registered data analysis plan. I like that. He understood the idea of harking, and he calls it hindsight bias, which is, of course, exactly the same. Here are the parking lots for your stuff. I mentioned already the Open Science Framework. It's really good and it's wonderful. Dataverse is working quite well. You can put protocols, you can put data, you can put data analysis plan. And you can say who has the keys. For some of the stuff, you have only yourself the key. Sometimes you can make it open and completely public, or anything in between. And you can also have embargo for a specific amount of time. But the main thing is that it is there, it's time-stamped, and you cannot touch it anymore without leaving traces. That is basically the idea. Mendeley, when you don't mind making Elsevier still a little bit richer, you can use Mendeley. It is for free, but I'm sure they found out a way to make money out of that as well. Doesn't matter. This is an interesting website. It explains all these thousands of data repositories. Some are quite specialized. My only warning is don't start a repository yourself. The repository which you need is probably there already, so explore that first. Figshare, I have no experience with that, but people are really positive on it, and Dryad is another one. These are the big ones on this slide. And this is this wonderful idea I wanted to tell you about. It's so wonderful. Sometimes you see an idea, I said, well, what a pity that I didn't invent this myself, and I did not. Registered reports. The idea is that you write an introduction paragraph and a method section first. You send that to a journal. You have no data, you have no nothing. You send that to a journal. They send it out for review, and the reviewers decide whether they like it, and the editor decides whether they want to publish it. They've got everything they need. They can judge whether it's a relevant question, and they can judge whether the methods are sound. They don't have the results, so they're not distracted by the results. So away goes selective reporting. And there is one bonus. The bonus is that the referees can comment on the methods and help people to improve the methods. I'm a methodologist myself, and I'm always frustrated that I'm commenting on the methods of a paper I see, but it's too late. They've done the results already. It's not going to help anymore. But now it's going to help them. Isn't this wonderful? It's really wonderful. It's early in the early adoption phase. It's still new. Here you see it's from I think it was from Science a few months ago. This is the number of pre-registration. It's pushing 20,000, which is not a lot, of course. And this is the number of journals adopting registered reports at less than 200. But you see, it's going exponential. And this is the future. This is what happened. And this is what I believe you should do, or at least consider to do in ILSI journals as well. Now, this is in the later phase of adoption, at least in biomedicine. This is about reporting guidelines. I'm sure you have heard about the Equator Network. It's wonderful. It's really wonderful. And they now have more than 400 reporting guidelines, and they select them really critically on their websites. You will heard about the CONSORT for clinical trials, probably heard about the START for diagnostic studies, and the ARRIVE for animal studies, but there are many, many, many more. And it's so useful. It helps you to write a paper, it helps you to judge a paper, and it helps you to read a paper. And many journals are now making this mandatory, this reporting guideline, and I believe it's an excellent idea. Finally, preprints are popular in natural sciences, especially in physics, already for a long time, for about 30 years. Now they're gaining traction in biomedicine and social sciences. And it's a good idea. It's a really good idea. Because when you have a preprint, people can immediately see what you found. I put all my stuff now in preprints nowadays. They can comment upon it. They can improve the papers. And they can help to do a better job. And there is one bonus here as well. One of the first preprints I was involved with about a year ago, so it's new for me as well, we got within a day, within 24 hours, we got an email from an editor-in-chief of exactly the journal where we wanted to send the paper to later on, begging whether she could have the paper. And it's so nice. It's the world upside down. Normally, we are begging to editors. Now was an editor begging to us. It was such a nice experience. Wonderful. The funding agencies, well, they can check whether the institutions are eligible. I will allude to that in the next two slides. They can demand transparency in the sense that we have been alluding to pre-registration, the protocol and the data analysis plan, and also parking of the data sets. They can prescribe open access. I don't know about the other parts of the world, but in Europe, open science is now a big thing. All the politicians, they say open science. They have normally no clue what they mean, but it's a buzzword nowadays. So they make it mandatory in all the big granting funding agencies and also the European funds. It needs to be open, open, and open. And nothing to complain about, but I do not fully understand that it's not necessary for everything, and there are downsides to it as well. But journals can demand it, and they can also funding agencies can demand it, and they can, and maybe should, also fund research on research. Because a lot of the stuff I've been telling you is still not really evidence-based. We know so little about how science functions and how science works. And meta-research or research on research is the new brand of activities that study that. And it's increasingly growing. This is, for instance, a program we have in the Netherlands. It's a small program, but it's interesting. It's called Fostering Responsible Research Practices, and it's research on research. And this is another program. I'm chairing this program committee, so I need to declare that conflict of interest here, on replication studies. And it's so nice, because no one is funding replication studies. And now we have a small program, which is good. And we were so surprised. Normal people were saying, well, no one will apply for that thing. You must be a stupid scientist to apply for replication studies. We need to do innovative work. We do need to do new work. That is not the case. Many talented people, half of the Young Academy of Sciences in the Netherlands, they applied for this program because they immediately recognized that this is important. Replication is important. Now, and what can institutions do? I told you, you're a bit of a funding agency, you're a bit of a journal, you're a bit of a research institute. You need to have clarity about what is expected. Have good codes, good guidelines, and good standard operating procedures. When you're not clear what you expect from your people, they're not going to do it because they don't know what is expected. You need fair procedures for handling allegations. When there are complaints or allegations of breaches of research integrity, you need to have fair procedures, because it's easy to make life difficult for a colleague you don't like. And on the other hand, being a whistleblower is risky as well. It hardly ever ends well for whistleblowers. We know that. So you need to protect them as good as possible. So on two sides, this is not easy. And you need to handle it carefully, carefully, carefully. It's really difficult. You need adequate mentoring and training, of course, in responsible conduct of research. You need adequate statistical and methodological support, because part of what I'm saying is ethical, part is methodological, and most of the stuff is a combination of the two. But you need to have expert consultation in methods and statistics as well. It's so easy to make mistakes. And this is the second thing. It's not a bad idea to have internal audits. I don't like the idea of external audits of science, but it might be necessary in some instances. But internal audits, when they are a bit playful, you can learn so much from it. And you check the work of your colleagues are checking the work of you, and the work improves for everyone. Good facilities for data management and storage. It's typically demanded by organizations funding research nowadays. We need to try to remove the perverse incentives in the reward system. That is not easy at all, not at all. And we need to promote an open research climate. That is not easy at all either, but it is so important. It's probably the most important. We are studying that in Amsterdam. I give you a few results about that already. Academic research climate in Amsterdam study. It's focusing on publication pressure, on parameters of the research climate, and a few more things. Below this slide are the preprints. Nothing is completely published, but we have four preprints on this project. So when you're interested, look at the preprints. This is the new code of conduct, another conflict of interest. I was one of the writers of the thing. And this code of conduct tried to make the best of many worlds. We used the Australian, the Canadian, the Danish, and the Irish code of conduct because we like that most. And we combine the materials and try to improve from it. And what is unique in this code is that we take a positive approach. That's not completely unique. Other codes do that as well. But we have 61 really specific standards how to perform research. And what is completely unique is that we have 21 standards for research institutions. They have norms and standards as well. And the research institutions in my country rather like that. I'm a bit surprised by it, but they like it because it gives them guidance how to get their act together. Have a look at it. It's all freely available on the web. In this piece, I recently defended more or less why we believe in self-regulation, because many people say you need laws on research integrity and national committees and criminologists and lawyers being involved. I don't think so. With a few exceptions, it's much better, and you learn much more when you are in the process of being responsible as a sector. But you need to take responsibility, and you need to be open about what you do and how you do it. Now, finally, this again is like carrying coals to Newcastle, but you do have some challenges in nutritional research. This is the stuff I made the slide this morning, what I was reading while I was on the airplane down here. This is a book, and the book does not say nice things about ILSI. It seems that there is some work to be done. This is making clear, all these articles, how difficult nutritional research is in humans, and one or two of the presentations explained that as well, quite nicely, much more elegantly than I could have been done. So there are some challenges, and you need to get your act collectively together, be more open about what you're doing, and recognize the questionable research practices in your field, because they're there, of course, And you have the difficulty, which I admire, that you take that aboard, the difficulty to make public-private collaboration work and work in the right way. That is not easy, but it can be done. I'm not one of the people who believe that it is impossible to do it, but some people do believe that, and you need to show that it can be done. Now, this is a cartoon. You've seen that before. Probably it's about the foolishness of many epidemiological research. It's my field, but this is nutritional epidemiology. This means coffee can cause depression in twins. And I read on the plane, chocolate milk alleviates symptoms of concussions in high school football players. You've seen this case before. And it has been proven to be a case of real research misconduct as well. So awful things happen in your field as well. And I wish you luck in improving it. And I applaud you for trying that so well, because I was impressed what I read about ILSI and what I heard over lunch. Now, last three slides. We do need more research on research. That's really important. And I hope that many other organizations will fund that in the future. We need to slow down. We need to report everything we do, but we need to do more slow science. Everything I was advocating here is taking time. And there are scientists, again, John Ioannidis wrote this paper, who write one paper every 5 days. That is impossible, of course. These are thousands of authors, which are not real authors, of course. They're cheating, but still. So slow down, do slow science, but do better science. And then maybe one of the most tricky points, we need to improve the situation as far as reward criteria are involved. This is a really nice article about how to do it differently. And now in Europe, this is gaining traction as well. Some universities are trying to do it differently. When they need to decide about the new professorship or the new department head or the new dean, don't only look at the HEERS index. Don't look only at the number of prizes and publications and citations, but making it a little bit broader. This, in fact, is one of the main themes of our next World Conference, the upcoming conference in Hong Kong. We will start with this paper, have discussion sessions, moving it forward, and try to help institutions to improve these reward criteria. This is the flyer. We are not predicting a tsunami when we are having the conference in Hong Kong, I can assure that. It's a bit funny, a bit weird picture. Please come to Hong Kong. It's promising to be a wonderful conference. And if you can't, on this website of the foundation, you find all the stuff of the former conference, videos, slide carousels, abstracts, everything, articles, you name it. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Working, yeah. That was really a wonderful talk, but there's inherent conflicts, you know. I wrote down a few, like, on the one hand, you could say cherry picking of papers to go in a meta-analysis, but on the other hand, if you want rigor and responsibility, you want to take only the papers that had the best quality outcome measures, you know, so you're fighting. And borderline significance, but p-values are arbitrary, and we're challenging where they should be for various fields. So we've got a lot yet to work out, yeah. I would say.
Yeah, that's true. I've said a lot, but I've not said that it's going to be easy.
Right. I think we have to break, and yeah. I think a lot of people will be finding you for questions, but our break, please come back in at five after.
Sorry, Connie, maybe we should take a few questions.
Do you think we could delay the break?
We can take 5 minutes, yeah.
All right. Great. Because this will be fun.
So that was very fascinating. I'm Adam Drunowski, ILSI Research Foundation. But you and the journal editors are still looking at science as an individual enterprise. And journals now ask authors to describe what it is that each author did, from development of the study to implementation to analysis, writing of the paper, and so on. Those same journals publish papers with the number of authors varies between 300 and 700. And this is endemic in cancer epidemiology, global burden of disease, anything to do with the microbiome, you have 700 authors. Now, there are two problems. One is that I don't believe that each and every one of those 700 authors has contributed. In one case I looked at, one of the authors had been dead for 7 years. True story. And then when you come to the faculty council, I serve on the faculty council, people come and say, I have got 20 papers where I'm author number 300 out of 700, and I want to be promoted to associate professor with tenure. You touched on that in your last two slides. So then what should journal editors do, and what should faculty councils do?
Well, thank you for this comment. The short answer is I agree. The slightly longer version is that yes, I like qualified authorship as well, but it ends, of course, when you have maybe 10 or 12 authors. When the number is larger, it's more difficult. And you may know it, the world record of number of authors is 5,300.
Oh my God.
And that is a paper from CERN in Geneva, where all the scientists in particles, science, physics, collaborate together. And recently I talked to one of these people and I said, how stupid, how can you have 5,300 authors? They said, well, that means nothing for us. We know what everyone did, but we have we say together, we co-author all the important papers, we collaborate. So then authorship means nothing or not the normal thing, but they do have a register inside explaining exactly who did what. And when they promote people, they don't look at how many papers they authored at all. So there are different subcultures in academia as well there.
Do we have more questions?
Okay, then how about 10 after, Stefan? Are we okay? Yeah. Take a break.
Sorry to interrupt.
That was awesome.